Michael Magnus Eriksson. Michael, it's a pleasure to have you here. The title of this seminar is The Contribution of Mining to Sustainable Development, which has a lot of interesting angles, and I'm sure you will tell us more about what it means in a minute. Magnus has a long record in the area. You're now visiting professor at Umea University, which is one of the most distinguished mining universities in Europe. And probably even more important, you were the founding director of the Raw Materials Group in Stockholm, a group that has set up a huge database on mining and investment and economics and lots of interesting things. You were also a member of many expert commissions throughout Africa and in other parts of the world. Did I mean anything? Probably lots of things. You're also main editor.
Flattery will get you so.
So I could probably continue and take your time to just say what a great guy you are in that area and outside this area. I'm really flattered and honored to have you here. And I'm pretty sure the sort of experience and insights you've gained throughout your career, but also especially for this report that you are disseminating here, will give us great insights and understanding of how the sector is organized, what the contribution is and could be, and indeed also ask some challenging questions afterwards. So, Magnus, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Raman. We have known each other for 10 years or something when you were still in Wuppertal. The only thing I remember from Wuppertal was this raised underground, what do you call it there?
A suspension railway.
Yes, where this elephant fell out in 1902 or something.
Was it that back in the 50s, an elephant was falling
out
of
it? Was it in the 50s, yeah.
Funny
I was
story.
Very worried about traveling on that one. But,
so it's much safer here in London. Elephants in the underground.
Exactly.
Usually.
Let me start directly with, and for those of you with some of are a bit familiar with our work, but I try to have a global view of things. And to start off, I'd like to put you like in the mood that you should have the Pacific in focus. This old world with the Atlantic in the focus, you can forget about that. Europe should be situated like it is here, far north and to the side, so to say. These circles here are proportional to the value of mine output in each country. And the green color, that's iron ore. Copper is red, of course, the red metal. Yellow, that's gold. And, well, there are other indicators here. But I'd like to, rather than you expect a lot of answers from me, if we look at Europe, do you know how many metal mines there is in the, let's say, the EU 28? Just to start off. Well, Raymond, you're embarrassing. More than five, yes. But less than 500. So I did a quick count just to demonstrate that what you said, Raymond, that we have all the mines in our database. And if we take EU 28, I think there were around 120 mines operating, large and small. And what is interesting is perhaps that many of them are in areas, even in Europe, where they make a big difference in the local and regional economy. This University of Luleå, where I am, in the northern part of Sweden, it's more than 1,000 kilometers north of Stockholm. And in that area, well, I would say 90% of the iron ore of the entire EU 28 is produced there, a large share of the copper. A lot of metals is produced in that area. Mining is absolutely vital to all the local activities, the local communities. Another aspect which I think is important, and perhaps not so many people touch upon when it comes to mining, and it has bearing on environmental issues and so on, that is how much, what is the physical volumes which are handled in this sector. And you can see here that it's quite huge quantities. Perhaps this might be slightly underestimate here. Approaching 100,000 million tons every year. A lot of this is, of course, aggregates, but you can see that metals, that's 12,000 million tons of ores, and barren rock, that is overburden that you have to remove to get to the ore bodies, whether it's an open pit or an underground operation, twice that volume, something like that. Industrial minerals, much smaller. Are you familiar what an industrial mineral is?
No.
Well, that's, for example, clays of various types, filling material for plastics and paper and that type of thing, which are not metals. Much smaller, but still a few thousand million tons. Coal, about 20,000 million tons in total. 8,000 million tons is the production, and aggregates, that is sand and gravel for construction purposes and for road building, etc., perhaps 15,000 million tons. It's very difficult to get, and I really get to grips with that. But these here, these two and that one, you can measure very much in detail. And it gives you sort of a flavor to what the volumes handled in this industry are. So my proposed agenda for today, which I hope you will agree with me on, is that I'll discuss a little bit what has been happening in the mining sector recently. I'll talk a bit about the Sustainable Development Goals, and then I'll share with you this report, which is the role of mining in national economies, which is that's where this MCI, Mining Contribution Index, is developed. It is it was produced by the ICMM, the International Council for Mining and Metals, together with Oxford Policy Management Group in Oxford and the Raw Materials Group in those days in Stockholm. Talk a bit about the future of mining as it looks today, in the not too long-term future, but what we see in the next couple of years, perhaps, and make some conclusions. But before I go into that, I would like to explain a little bit about myself. I wear two hats, the University of Luleå, and you have seen here on the slides SNL Mining and Metals, which is a global data provider, which a couple of years ago bought the business that I set up, as Raymond described, in Stockholm in the, actually in the early 1970s, and then developed that to be a database over all mines in the world. And it's interesting that in those days, in the early 1970s, it wasn't the 1870s, but then mining was very much in focus in those days as well. But there were slightly different focus than it is today. It was very much an issue of who is in control of mines and mining decisions about where mines are located and where mining is, where mineral commodities are produced. And that was the background to why we started the Raw Materials Group, which gradually grew from being an NGO to a more of a consultancy. After some time, you have to earn a bit of money as well, so that's how we developed. My post in Luleå is a part-time post, and I'm great pride in that I'm a chemical engineer, really a microbiologist and biochemical engineer, and I've had this, yes, it's a part-time professorship in mineral economics. Which makes me very happy, and some of my colleagues very unhappy. I started talking a bit about Europe. Let me give you also a bit of background in more to the Swedish mining industry. This cartoon and some of the others shows part of that. I'll explain more of that later on. But this is the story behind this copper mine called Falun. It is about 250 kilometers north, west of Stockholm. It's said that a farmer there, his goat, and this is the goat, his name is Kore. He went out and he was looking for grass, I suppose, and he came back with his antlers like radish, and the farmer couldn't really understand what he was, so he, next day he followed him, and then he found this large copper deposit, which was at least in written material documented as far back as 1288, and it continued until 1995 or something, continuous operation. It's still in operation, but it's UNESCO World Heritage now. I'd also like to show you this photo. It's a very modern mine in Sweden. It is, actually I have our family cottage, summer cottage, just a kilometer to the north of here. And it's another interesting mine. It's been operating on and off for more than 700 years. One really doesn't know how long. There are no records for this mine as detailed as the other. But its name in itself is very interesting. Do any of you know German?
Yes.
Yes. Berg means mountain, but in this case it actually means more the a mining area, an area where a specific mining legislation was in place. And you might not know this, but Garp Rami means German. So this was a mine, it was the German mine, and it has been at least in operation 700 years. So it's also an indication, I think, and quite a nice one, that mining has always, even in those days, been very international, perhaps not global as it is today, but nevertheless. So some recent developments here. Metal prices have seen quite a disastrous decline in the past year and also in 2014. Here are some examples. Iron ore prices fell there by 62%, for example, over 2014. And you can really, as David Humphries pointed out, we're in a post-boom period now. There's no doubt about this. And it seems as if some of the metal prices will continue to fall also in 2016, even though we might be getting closer to the bottom of the cycle here. And I won't dwell too much on this, but of course the slowing of the growth, the lower growth of the Chinese economy plays a major role here. If we look at the value of mining companies, it has really fell very dramatically, and if you read the papers in recent days, also their profits are down very much. But, and this I think is very interesting, there is not a slowdown in the same way at all in demand. Production of most metals are going up, is going up, and these are figures that gives an example of this. So the present post-boom period is not primarily, as I see it, is driven by a lowering in demand. But of course, the total value of world mine production is going down. This is an attempt of estimating the value of metal production, and this is only up to 2013. It will certainly drop also for 2014 and 2015. But compared to the situation that we had here 10 years ago, we're still at fairly safe levels, so to say. I will slowly get into the sustainability aspects here. Here is just a picture showing how the GDP growth has been fairly steady, but mining has really shot up and it's now going down, coming down further here, and probably the growth of the mine value will be lower than the GDP in Tokyo.
Excuse me, is that also part of the fact?
No, no, this is the value of the production at the mine stage. It's the same figures here. You remember the first global map I showed you with all the circles? This is the same figure here, in which I used for that. So there's market cap.
So it's sales. Not, it's sales.
Not sales, it's the value of production. You know, the sales, there might be other factors. So it's a, we have calculated simply the volume produced and multiplied by an average value of all metals and minerals. And with some corrections, because for many metals, such as aluminium, the value of the aluminium metal is not created at the mine, it's created in the smelter. So we do some adjustment to just look at the mining value. So, sustainable development goals. Well, probably many, this is the definition that we have used in the work with this publication here. Socially inclusive and cohesive, and environmental sustainable economic growth and prosperity. The goals, as you know, are divided in, at various levels. This is the highest level where there are 17 goals. And well, you can read these very well. I will dig down deeper into some of these because they are very much detailed. If we look at goal 8, for example, here, promoting economic growth, that's the short title. Here is the full title. Sustained, inclusive, sustainable growth, full and productive employment, decent work for all. Number 9 there, build resilient infrastructure, promote inclusive and sustainable industrialization and foster innovation. And goal 15, protect, restore and promote sustainable use of terrestrial ecosystems, sustainably manage forest, combat desertification, and halt and reverse land degradation and halt biodiversity loss. Also fairly high level, but you can dig down, and here is goal 8 as an example where it, how it is detailed if you look into the sustainability of the sustainable development goals. Sustain economic growth in least developed countries more than 7%. High productivity through diversification, technological upgrade, innovation, and so it goes on like this. Full employment for all men, women, young people, and disabled, equal pay, reduce youth not in employment. So it's really digging down into quite some details, these sustainable development goals. So what has the mining industry, what can it do in these areas? And there are a number of initiatives. The ICMM, which is also the mining contribution index, has developed a range of toolkits. The World Bank has a value chain approach. World Economic Forum has also, they have what they call minerals value management framework. These are 3 examples. I'm sure there are others, but these are the ones that I'll show you some details. ICMM, are you familiar with ICMM? It's located here in London, and it is an industry organization trying to promote the mining industry, of course. But they do it in many different ways. They have, for example, developed a community toolkit. They have looked into health and safety. And you see they're active in many fields. They were set up in about 15 years ago after a long study which was called MMSD.
explain all the relevance.
That's right, exactly.
You should have known that, remember that.
And after that study, which was a global study, inclusive and including a lot of NGOs and other interested parties in the mining sector, the ICMM was reorganized, or the industry organization was reorganized. It had a completely different focus earlier. It has now become much more, how shall I say, much more of a societal focus. If we go to the World Bank, they have this value chain approach, and they've been looking at how to optimize contracts and how can countries make their legislation and licensing for mining more transparent, more effective. How can countries regulate and monitor operations? And they have also, which is, I think, is an important aspect, is not only to focus on what are the taxes paid, but how can you really spend tax income from mining in a reasonable and you know, in a good way, to use a simple word. And also environmental aspects, and look at how can revenue be distributed, and to implement new policies. The World Economic Forum, they have what they call a value management framework. I have not myself been very much involved in this. The ICMM has the industry as its backer, so to say. They are a part in development. The World Bank also, through its lending activities and its experts role. I'm not quite sure what the World Economic Forum can really put behind there, behind these points that they have developed. But I know they gather the industry together with NGOs and other, and you can see it's similar focuses here with revenue streams, how are they managed, employment, skills acquisition, securing social cohesion and cultural gains. All these three initiatives work in very much the same areas, I would say. But let us look a bit in more detail on the MCI, the mining contribution index. Before doing that, and these cartoons, they are elements that were all firstly isolated by Swedish chemists. That's my chemical engineer's background here that shines through. First of all, the mining life cycle is a long one. I've already given you a couple of examples of very long-lived mines. And of course, each mine is in itself can be depleted, but mining districts live very long. You know, in Canada, there are some, the Sudbury district, in South Africa, we have the gold mines and the platinum mines north of that. In Sweden, we have, apart from those mines which I showed you earlier, we have iron ore mines which have all been operating more than 100 years. And the life cycle is a very long one. There is no time indications here, but you know, to start a mine takes probably more than 10 years in any case. And this are an indication of the economic activity or the employment levels and something like that. During construction of a mine, there is a lot of activity and a lot of people involved. That sort of levels off during the lifetime of the mine, and then comes a period after the mine is closed when activities will be very, very low. And this black line is an indication of the government revenue from a mine, where it initially it's very low, but then when the mine is in operation, the company will pay company tax, and there might be royalties levied on the production, and the employees will also contribute to revenues for government. But it's a long period of time. It's a long-term industry. You can also look at this from more of a product life cycle, and just to go through the various stages of the mine's life, where you have an exploration phase. I'll get back to that and discuss exploration a bit more later. You find something and you develop knowledge about your deposit and you create reserves, the mineral reserves, and then you have the mining and then the milling. And when I say we monitor the value, we monitor the value here. After that, you do more concentration and you do smelting and refining, and that also increases the value of the mine, the products. And it later on developed into a metal and manufactured into final products. And also, of course, you have a secondary metal cycle, and this has come very much into focus recently, particularly with EU policies, and I think that's also something which you are studying here to a large extent.
Definitely, the circular economy package that has been launched last year, and all the related work to it.
Yeah, exactly. I am focusing in this discussion mostly on this stage here. So what are the contributions of mining to a country's economy? This is taken from this report, and I've tried to take the most where the contribution is the largest part of the total on top, and that's direct investments, where often in mineral-rich, less developed economies, the mining part of foreign direct investment might be as much as 60 to 90% in many African countries, for example. When we look at the value of the exports of metals and mineral products, that's often not so much, but can be as much as 60% of total export of certain countries. Government revenue, there mining often contributes something like 30 to 20%. These figures come from a number of country studies that ICM has been undertaking. When we look at what is the share of GDP, that is often in the area of 3 to 10% for countries which are highly dependent on mining and minerals for their economy. While on the employment side, as you know, mining is very capital intensive. So the contribution to employment is much less, perhaps only a few percent of total employment. So when this study on the mining contribution index was started, we tried to see how can we measure these the impacts on various countries by looking at these indicators here. But that wasn't so easy as we had hoped. It's very difficult, it turns out, to actually find good indicators of foreign direct investments in all countries that we want to compare. You remember the first global map I showed you there. Around 100 or a little more, 120 countries are important mining producers. And if you want to be globally covering, it turns out it's almost impossible to find good information on this FDI situation. You have to make very detailed study of each country, and we wanted to have a global index. Exports are easier. This factor here we could include in this contribution index. Government revenue is another fairly difficult issue. In spite of initiatives like, you know, the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, EITI, which do monitor these factors for some countries, we could not find indicators or enough data to monitor this stage here either. The GDP there, we can include that in the contribution to this. But we also had to say that employment figures is very difficult to get hold of. There is ILO in Geneva, does collect statistics, but it's often very old figures. Some of the figures in their statistics might be 15 years old. And we wanted to try to capture a snapshot of the world rather than, you know, something which was a bit dated. And this is very, how shall I put it? This is very depressing almost, that it is so difficult to find indicators where you can actually monitor the situation. And that, you know, relating back to my own long history in mining, as I told you a bit about, it was the same. We wanted to understand who controlled mining. There weren't any figures, so that we started the database, but that took 20 years to build, so we couldn't use that in this case. What we have and what you can, I have a few copies of the study. I'd be very happy to share those with you, and you can also order more from or get more from ICML. A couple of examples on a country basis. So this is the fiscal income in Zambia over a period of time. It only goes up to 2012. We did a study in 2014, so we could only find data until 2012. But you can see here the composition of taxes, and here is the taxes, mineral taxes as percentage of all taxes, and this line is, this is mineral taxes as percentage of all taxes paid. So it's at a peak when metal prices were high, also tax income was very high. So we can expect that tax income has fallen here in years, later years. But there is a definite improvement in the situation over the periods in this time frame here, which is partly dependent on that copper prices. It's mostly copper in Zambia were not so high, and production were not so high. But it also other factors were certainly at play. So we had to be satisfied with only being able to monitor three indicators. First, the contribution to exports, and then we wanted to have a dynamic aspect, so we added also the change in export contribution between 2010 and 2012. 2010 was the first edition of this study, and then we looked at the metals and minerals and coal as a share of GDP, the value of these as a share of GDP. And this is what we came up with. And let me explain this a little. We didn't do an absolute measure. What we could measure was only a relative measure. So in this, yeah, you see that there, those red countries are those countries where mining contributes most to the economy according to those three indicators. What it is in absolute terms, we don't know. But we only noted that these are the highest quintile, the 20% where the contribution was highest. And then you see these are countries, the blue ones, where contribution is little less, green in the middle, and then the brown and the yellow. Those are the countries where mining contributes least. So you can see that there are many countries in Africa here where, those red countries here, where mining actually contributes quite considerably to or contributes importantly, I shouldn't say considerably, to their economies. And even in a country like in Australia, where mining is very important, it doesn't contribute as much at all. And when I say it's important, I mean in terms of global production. And you can see in even in Canada and the US are in the group where the top 40% of most important countries in terms of these three indexes, the export contribution and the value share of mining relative to GDP. In Europe, well, Sweden and Finland, important, but not so much. Poland is the most important mining country in terms of mining contribution in all Europe, and of course, Ukraine is also another a country where mining means a lot, and some of the countries in the Balkans as well. This is another way of looking at it, and you can see here that these are the figures that we calculate, but they don't really mean anything more than that they are a relative measurement. But I find it quite interesting that Mauritania, Eritrea, Guyana, these, and Congo, the DRC, and even Korea, Suriname, Guinea, Burkina Faso, Botswana. These are all countries where mining means quite a lot. We can also see here, this here is an indication of the change in which quintile these countries were in the previous measurement. If we continue down, we see that, as I said, in terms of Europe, that in Europe, mining is not very important, which is the effects of mining, which in this contribution index was we were not able to monitor or measure as well as we would have liked to, but you can. Divide them into direct effects here, indirect and induced effects. And these boxes here are corresponding to what I said earlier, that the capital and expenditure, that's the investment, the operating expenditures are also generating employment, etc. And if we look at starting with the membership of ICMM, that's most of the 25 largest mining companies in the world. The value of a mine, the value that a mine generates, roughly 50 to 65% of that is capital expenditure and operating expenditure. Salaries and wages account for some 10 to 20%. Community spending, much lower level, half to 1%. Taxes between 15 and 20%. And then financing costs and profits for the shareholders, on average 15 to 20%. And if we look at what influences how well these various type of costs are influencing local economies or national economies, I should say. On the operating expenditure side, that's an issue. Are there local suppliers available? To what extent could local suppliers be supported and be available and provide services of such a type that they could be interesting for and for the mine. Capital expenditure, to what extent that contributes to the local or national economy, is more dependent on the industrial base of a country, like in South Africa, where there is a certain level of development, where there are production of mining equipment to some extent, etc. The salaries and wages of how well that we contribute is dependent on the skill space. Are there local people available, or is it a large share goes to expatriates? On the community side, it's been the experiences of ICMM members. That are there development partners available? Those costs and those expenditure can be spent very well. Taxes, of course, depends on the fiscal regime. How much of the financing can be done nationally? It depends on, is there a domestic bank system? And on the profit, some of it might go back to local and national economy, provided there is some local shareholders or government, if government has a share in the company, which is becoming more common that national governments demand to have, you know, 5, 10, 15% free carried interest, which they don't have to pay for. So I must say that the exercise we did to try to really find good indicators for the contribution of money wasn't really as successful as I had hoped it should be. As I said, we did a first attempt in 2010, and we thought that we should be able to include employment, for example, in our second edition, but it isn't. It wasn't the case, and I think it's quite disturbing that the statistics on such elementary issues aren't available, and I think it would be very useful to have that. Let me then, I don't know where I'm heading time-wise, but okay. Return back to where I started. Where are we heading now then? Well, very briefly, I think, as I've already said, that the demand for metals will remain on a high level. It's dependent on the growth of population, urbanization and industrialization levels. It's also a fact that you really can't very easily substitute many metals. They have, you know, copper, gold, silver, they do transfer heat and electricity more effectively than other metals. So, and in all, there is a relation between economic development and metal demand. So in our view, in my view, demand for metals will remain high, even if there is a slowdown of the world economy. On the supply side, though, I see a number of barriers which will make it more difficult in the future to meet those demands, which is steadily growing. Mines are in remote locations under often harsh conditions, and deposits are deeper down, which means that it's more difficult to find them and also more difficult to develop them. And the permitting, to get your permit, your license to mine, whether it's formal or it's informal licenses, social license to operate, takes long time. And we also see now an increase in corporate concentration. I don't know what that will mean, but I think it will affect supply. I already indicated a couple of times that I don't think we will fall down to the same levels that we saw before the boom period. In our analysis, we are getting closer to the bottom. It might be that we fall a little further here, but we see definitely at the end of 2017 or early 2018, we might see an increase in metal prices again, which might then again open up opportunities for emerging economies to make use of these commodities, these raw materials for their economic development. This is I mentioned earlier the 12,000 million tons of ore. These are our forecasts for how this will increase in the next almost 10 years, from 12 perhaps up to 15,000 million tons. And in spite of an increase in opportunities in recycling. I am a bit worried about the future in the terms, in the sense that, that exploration is the way the money you spend to find new deposits. Exploration is varying like this here with metal prices. But really, if demand is growing, exploration should increase steadily to, because if demand is increasing, you will need to find more into the future, and to find more, you must spend a bit more money. At the same time, it's getting more difficult to find. So even if you want to find a new deposit, it's deeper down, it will cost more. You have to actually spend a little more to overcome these increasing technical difficulties. And thirdly, if you look at historic success rate for exploration, it's going down. So to account for that lack or loss of efficiency, you should spend even more on exploration, but it's going down. It's going down further than this also. And this it makes it a bit worrying, because that might mean in the future that we'll see another situation where demand cannot be met and exploration has not been sufficient to find and locate those ore bodies. And then we will have another price spike, and these fluctuating metal prices is not good for countries, it's not good for companies either, I would say. So my conclusion are that the need for metals remain. There are no real alternatives. We can't start using carbon fibers, etc. In huge quantities. Steel will be the most important construction material. Demand is strong, and I think we will see a turnover at the end of 2017. And I think that most governments and particularly governments and also local communities, like in northern Sweden, they need to have an understanding of this long-term perspective and don't get too worried about lower prices right now. Mining will be needed into the future. And as I said, I think we can very well see a strong increase in prices in a couple of years' time. And I think that for many countries mining is the key to economic and social progress at the present stage. And many mining, many deposits, mineral-rich countries are at a very low economic development level. And they offer them opportunities in these countries, provided that you can deal with all the problems that are definitely associated with mining. And we conclude in this study here that perhaps the focus on sustainability of mining should not be so much on the mine itself, but how the products coming out of the mine or out of the mine could contribute to sustainable development. And I've listed here a few of the aspects. And one is, and I think it shouldn't be forgotten, that metals are elements, so they are indestructible, can be part of a circular economy. In theory, it's complete and circular, but in theory, in practice, it might not be so easy. But it is also, and I think that's another aspect which I would like to underline, that it is a long-term business, and the mineral deposit cannot be moved. If you I've had a bit of a discussion in Luleå where Google has built all its server halls, and that has, people think that's fantastic, but I say, you know, if prices of electricity are suddenly lower in Canada somewhere, all these server halls will be moved and relocated, but the mines, they will not very easily be relocated. And mining creates a demand for infrastructure and services. And if you can use those railway lines or other services for other purposes, it could be very, very reasonable. And finally, I think one should underline that so far, no industrialization, no economic development has taken place without metals as a key component. So thank you very much.
not just for these great pictures that illustrate the important contribution of Swedish researchers and Swedish scientists in the past to the topic of your speech, but also indeed for all the other issues you have shared with us. The floor is now open for discussion. We take some 30 minutes or so for Q&A. I see one hand already has gone up, so I would like to give you the floor there, and then we start the discussion with others.
Yeah. Thank you. Can I ask about sustainability, where you have some admirable list of goals of sustainability, but I don't see anywhere mentioned the Paris conference in December. I heard yesterday that for instance, the airlines, that I forget the overall body that controls the airlines, have agreed to zero emissions by set off. Now, the implication is there is a huge need for climate change to urgently and thoroughly, as the United Nations says, to cut our emissions as a whole. And admittedly, you pointed out that mining is only part of a end process. In Britain, I believe building, which uses a lot of metal, steel, especially steel, copper, and a lot of zinc, and you know, it's an end product, of course. It's not purely the mine that is causing about a third of our British carbon emissions that has to be severely and urgently cut. I mean, can you say why you are not in control of the demand for the metals that you are representing? You must have taken on board that this World United Nations conference has said we've got to go zero carbon. And, I mean, take for example the nuclear industry that extracts mines uranium, say, amongst other basic fuels, iron and aggregate. The three nuclear power stations taking 10 years, is it, to build? This is a huge amount of steel and concrete to make it what people once thought was a low carbon fuel, but it's not a low carbon fuel. How do you see your movement towards low carbon in a climate change context?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, the reason why I didn't mention any of that is basically that we did most of the work before that conference, of course. But these sustainable development goals are also, they were taken in Rio de Janeiro, and they are sometimes conflicting with because to build a more carbon-free world, for example, in steel industry, you could do not the blast furnace, but do steel production in other ways that could reduce the CO2 emission quite dramatically. But that in itself also creates demand for some metals, you know, like in wind turbines, you need certain metals to make them efficient. So it will be a very difficult aspect and a very difficult battle. I don't have the answer to that. What I have an answer to, and which makes life very complicated, is really that when you talk to African governments, I mean, what they say is that, well, are we not going to be able to develop the same way or in a similar way, it won't be the same way, as you have done in Europe, simply because you have created all these problems. We haven't contributed a lot to us. I was in South Africa a couple of weeks ago and discussed this. And this, when those arguments come, it's that creates another problem. I couldn't really, you know, well, what? It's difficult. But I can show you. This is, as I'm sure you've been working with this type of thinking, Raymond. This is copper production, and up here is demand for copper. When economies are growing very fast, the demand is increasing rapidly like it is here. This production historically can be seen as a graph for demand. But if we are here now, the products have a certain lifetime. So what was produced 20 years ago, is that sufficient to meet all the demands which are today? Even if you, because you can't recycle only that which was produced 30 years ago and which has come to its lifetime end, you can recycle. So that, looking at it this way, there will be a demand, even if this growth curve isn't as steep as it is here, there will still be a need for virgin materials into the future.
It is actually really one of the questions that also fuels our research agenda here. What is the implication of Paris, the Paris Agreement, and what is the implication of the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, on the use of materials for our economy? My tentative answer is probably there is a requirement for a more asymmetric type of pathway, where you, if you follow the decarbonization agenda, you would need to reduce fossil fuels, but you would also have a replacement. And following the other sustainable development goal, there is likely to be increasing demand for lots of materials, which is mineral fertilizers for the sustainable development goal on ending poverty, which is increasing demand for metals following the sustainable development goal, goes on both increased water sanitation for all, which means water distribution infrastructure, and renewable energies all around, which means increased demand for iron ore, steel, for a number of other metals. So probably it's really like a proof, it is a test for mining industry to what extent they can also change and develop new business models and extract some materials less, basically fossil fuels, and some others more, while probably the long-term perspective then would need to go towards a circular economy. But figuring these changes out, it is interesting, and I really look
Isn't
forward to
Isn't it so also,
Robin,
that there has to be an asymmetry between Europe and other parts of the world? I mean, the European input and American input has to be much larger than from other parts
of
the world.
Well, of course. I mean, this is the principle of what is it, what polluters pays principle, basically that the industrialized countries will have accepted the largest share of whatever needs to be done, decarbonization. So Europe indeed has adopted goals that are quite radical in that regard. The Americans hopefully will follow sooner or later, wait for the presidential election. So it might not be that certain, but in principle, the industrialized countries will need to take this responsibility. Absolutely right. But still, there could be this asymmetrical type of reduction where parts of mining might need to be reduced, or parts of extractive industry actually, while in particular the role of metals is likely to be more important than it has been in the last decades. More discussion of this? I'm pretty sure. You first and then others.
Thank you very much. Ian von Greta from the Development Planning Union, just around the corner. We look at sustainability mostly from my department, focusing on the Global South, from an environmental justice perspective. And if we look at, through that lens, mining is the equation needs another component. It's quite a biased, I think, the story, because despite all the contributions of mining, it's also very destructive. So I wonder, I'm Mexican, so I'm aware of the Mexican cases, both cases in Colombia, in Brazil, the latest, you know, the Andean disaster, in Colombia, in Chile, in Argentina. So what we're seeing is that the industry actually uses particular practices that are forbidden in the countries of the north, because corporations decide. They use cyanide, but it's banned in the U.S., in the EU, but it's used widely in Latin America. But it's also very active in actually deregulating. So seeking actively how to reduce regulation so that it's more favorable for industry. So I understand the global picture, but to me it's a very, I don't know how the industry is actually trying to grasp the reality of the other side of the industry, which is quite, it could be quite dark. I mean, we can mention human rights abuses, we can mention all sorts of things that are happening simultaneously. So I wonder how these measurements of the industry, and particularly when you talk about sustainability, are really thought through, or are we just trying to mention one side of the story, which is, I think, increasingly problematic. This is my personal perspective.
Well, I think one interesting aspect of this is, if we look at, as you said, that in the south there are the mining industry might follow slightly different rules than they are in Europe, for example. And to me it's a bit embarrassing that also the European Commission and European policy is really aimed at reducing mining in Europe, for example, where it is undertaken under completely different, or at least rules are followed and there are national governments are able to monitor and push on and as see to it that regulations are followed. So here I think that the from a European perspective it would be advantageous if mining, it would be good for the local communities in the periphery of Europe where mining takes place, and it would also be good from a more global perspective. But you know, you mentioned cyanide. I'm not sure that I don't know the details in the U.S. But if you look at cyanide and compare it to other mercury methods, it has its advantages. So I'm not representing the mining industry here, but I think one has to be very careful in evaluating various technologies available. And one of the major aspects of reducing impact of mining is to make sure that of the metal which is in a deposit, all of it is actually taken out and used. Today, you know, in many technologies, only 80% of the metal which is mined is actually will turn into a metal. The remaining 20% will be disposed of in tailings dams, etc. And so if you can find a technology which reduces those 20% to 15%, you have actually improved the effectiveness of mining by, you know, almost 10%. So technology, I think, is very important. Another thing which is very important and relates to your question directly is that we looked at the impact of Chinese mining companies in Africa. And when we did that, it was quite clear that Chinese mining companies in countries where there was at least some capacity of government to monitor what was doing and to enforce rules, which is in Africa, mainly in South Africa, which is not it might not be the best, but they are much better than in Sierra Leone and other countries. And in countries where there was a regulatory capacity, the Chinese mining company followed the rules. And I think that is a key also in many of the Latin American countries that you know, there has to be a national set of regulation that has to be a capacity to enforce those. And of course, that is something which is, the Chinese companies in Africa are an example that when rules are lax, they behave in a lax way. And I think that goes partly for other mining companies as well.
Could I ask you in this context, eventually, when you have rich experience in Africa and have also helped in some capacity development issues in Africa, would you eventually say a few words of what has happened to set up organizations within Africa that could help to curb resource curse environmental justice issues there?
Well, what you referred to, Raymond, is something called African Mineral Development Center, AMDC, which was set up after a long process. And you know, if we are used to here in Europe that it's difficult to obtain a European policy in Brussels, it's equally more difficult in Africa. This was a project which was supported by African Development Bank, the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, and the African Union Commission. And I have to say that it has been bogged down in politics. And I did together with some colleagues the business plan for this setup, which was modeled on a similar organization set up in South Africa after the elections in 94, to provide government with well-trained people for government services. But the Africa Development Center, we put a lot of efforts that they should employ the best people, whether they are Africans or not. This has not happened. Has only been African people, persons, knowledgeable and good, but not the best. And the politics of things in Africa have become very difficult. In Latin America, I don't know the situation, but I'm sure there are not good cooperation between countries there either to deal with these problems. Do you have some examples of that? Of where countries or people, local communities have been able to cooperate to deal with the problem?
I see there are more terrible stories than good stories, but we won't take much time. Because what I'm saying is that the industry tends to actively try to reduce regulation, rather than promote regulation. There's a, and again, we have the case in Brazil, in Mexico, Pakistan, Al-Qaeda. So I'm just saying that the pyramid, I think, describes some part of industry.
Yeah.
But if we try to, as academia at least, not as industry representatives, but try to understand this, that the impact overall, we need to add other variables there to make it more real.
I agree.
Of the impacts.
But as I said,
for good and for bad. Yeah.
If we can, if we could fill all those the triangle we had, which we were not able to do, I think that would be good. And if we could add further, it would even be good. Probably we have to do with case studies.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Two more. Lots of more people. Are you still on? Over there, you raised your hand.
It's funny, well,
go on then. One, two, three, four, over there. So we're going on the circle here.
Yeah, Leon DeMarc, I'm a renewable energy consultant. I think it's very difficult to argue, by definition, that mining is sustainable. So I think that's what one of your slides effectively admitted that earlier on. But what we can do, and to go back to the first question, is that we can do proper life cycle assessments as to what the impacts are on the goods that we import and the products that we make. So that's one way of dealing with this stuff. But clearly we have to bear down on virgin metal demand. I mean, we can't possibly accept the fact that we're going on into the blue yonder, taking more and more virgin metals out. We clearly have to deal with that somehow. And I think I think you were probably incorrect that demand has actually gone down recently in the downturn. For I think supply may have gone up, but I think demand has gone down. And it bears on us to make sure that demand does not carry on indefinitely.
Yeah, I mean, I don't agree with you on the demand side, but otherwise there is a lot of truth in what you're saying. And what I was trying to emphasize is that, yes, a mine might be depleted. That's true, but the products that are produced are necessary for sustainable development. And even if, that could end there.
So the data analysis we do on, say, material footprints do not indicate that there was an absolute decline, not internationally. So it's really an interesting question also what data sources, what indicators we use, but I'm really eager to discuss it later on and move on here also to other contributors. Yeah, sorry.
Hi. I was just wondering, my name is Gustavo Espinosa, I'm a PhD student at the University of Westminster. I just was wondering if in the indicators, Atel is considering to use renewable energy working with mining production, such as, I don't know, for instance, in Chile, I think so they have from wind farms in order to produce some energy for producing
I mean, that's another excellent idea. The issue is that we were trying to do this globally. But as I said, in a case study, that could be very interesting, using wind farms or geothermal energy. Really, I think it's a good idea.
Because I think it seems like it's more focused in economic sides. I don't see too much focus in the social side of the communities. I only saw this ICEMM having the toolkit for community participation, but the other two.
This was to put emphasis on this development, sustainable development goal number 8, to create economic growth in
sustainable. I just wondered how the mining industry is reacting to the move towards fairly traded metals. I'm sure it's very, very small at the moment, but there is a move, isn't there, to produce or to source metals ethically.
You know, as far as I know, the German Geological Survey, for example, has developed methods to identify where tantalite and these coltan, where they originate from, so they can actually differentiate from which mine.
Is that a welcome?
Yes. That's welcome, and I mean similar tools have been developed for diamond production, and I think at least as far as I know it has been fairly successful in the diamond business. But diamond is such a difficult sector.
There's legislation on what is called conflict minerals, and this exists in the United States and in Europe. The implementation is a bit more sloppy, it's more challenging. Many regards, but you say it's moving as
well
to back to by the
like
law.
Us, I mean, look,
absolutely.
Metal, they're going to our mobile smartphones, and you know, not how many people are buying fair phones, we have that many, so let's go for it.
I mean, I know that there has been attempts at also having similar for gold production in jewelry, but I think that has been more difficult to find. Chemical methods of proving where the gold originates. But it has been, I know previously it was also used in you mentioned uranium, when uranium production in Namibia was illegal according to UN before it was independent. There was studies and tracing of uranium which was aimed at suing the Dutch government for using it.
Two more, please be short.
Yes.
You and then you finish the whole.
I thought it was a bit of a strange choice of title for this presentation because you've spoken a lot about the potential for economic growth from mining, but very little about the actual current impact of mining. Like if you look at all the countries that you've spoken about today, I think many of you want to have actually experienced it well and experienced a lot more negative impacts from having resources. Botswana and China may have been somewhere on the list. That's about it.
Yeah, all countries were on the list, but explain what about Botswana, don't you think that...
I think that's true. There's a potential to have big development impacts, but it's very rare, I think. You haven't spoken about any of the institutions that need to be in place, or sort of governance issues that really determine...
I understand what you're aiming at, but... I must say that you are unique, I think, in considering Botswana a poor example. That's one of the countries which are most often highlighted.
No, I don't think it's a poor example, but I think it's more
like
common. It's very different to the vast majority of the country.
Well, I mean, just to support the point, there is research going on, in particular, at this Resource Governance Institute, that they try to come up with indicators on how you can measure the contribution to real wealth. This is more institutionally oriented, and I would say that's certainly complementary. And we will probably need more time to discuss what the real contribution is, what sort of indicator GDP is, to what extent resource curse ideas make it a bit more flawed. Well, thank you very much indeed.
One more contribution here. You're there? Okay. Yeah, sorry.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's sort of backing up the sort of how you choose to present this, because you're talking about experts in dealing, but you also spoke about weak governments in those countries. So how can indeed this represent development of people in the country? So I think it's a gap there into what economic means and what environmental benefits and human rights issues and securities represent the country, represent the people in the country. So I think there's something there of a gap in your presentation, in the way you have chosen the development goal that you choose, eight, because it is about economic growth. There's plenty of others about it. So maybe just as a suggestion to enrich your research is to take on board human rights, for example, and also the type of sources of your information. So how about talking with union workers? What's the type of employment they see and these type of things? So that, I mean, they enrich as well. But definitely, I think there's a huge gap in human rights, so taking human rights on board in this type of presentations that ensure that these things are covered.
Yeah, no, I agree. But once again, this was an attempt to focus on the economic contributions, which are often sort of forgotten. And the aspects that you are mentioning are having, for example, I know that there is now being started something called the Responsible Mining Index, which is an attempt by a Dutch NGO we have been involved in. They are setting up to monitor the company performance on many of those aspects. So there are attempts to do that as well. And this was a first step in catching the economic, because without the economics, it will be very difficult to work in the other areas as well.
Yeah, but as pointed, even in the economics, this means just the country is exporting. It doesn't mean that people have
of course
to quantify. And it's basically
yes.
Because of the issue of governance. So even then, only in economics, it's a big capital.
I'm with you completely.
Well, thanks for all these valid points and statement. It's really great. To me, the conclusion would be that, as you mentioned, this has been the second edition of the report. There might be scope for a third edition then that would incorporate more social, environmental aspects, etc. It is a complex issue. And I'm really glad that you were here, and I'm also glad, Marcus, that you were here in particular. As Marcus had said in the beginning, there are a few copies available. So those of you who are interested should just come over and ask for a copy.
Yeah.
I would like to ask you joining me and giving a hand.